Sarah Richter, and I'll be presenting on Cornelia Parker, the essay Shifting Identities, Mutable Time. It is difficult to say when a form stops being one thing and starts being another. There have been multiple approaches to creating distinctions in time and identity through ceremony, mapping, preservation, and destruction. At some point, we distinguish seed from tree like we do from past and future. Yet there is in the realm of physics a single point in time may manifest as the present. And it is here that identities and landscapes are giving life and death, the future and past existing in memory and potential. Cornelia Parker is one such artist that tasked herself with approaching such conceptually polymorphic ideas and reframing them in a singular work consisting of objects both stationary and transformative. She demonstrates how identity can be compressed and expanded even as it appears for the viewer in a solitary structure using time, memory, and place as modifiers of our present. One such work that plays with past and future to portray identity is given in a two-part work in the form of a whole and exploded shed. This dual-natured piece in the form of said solid and exploded shed exists at varied points in time across multiple landscapes, in contact with people involved in various points of its life. Originating from its conception as a standard shed made from other sheds, to its destruction such an artificial explosive reassembly in a gallery setting. Beginning life as a work known as Cold Dark Matter and ending its journey as a piece in an exploded view, its rendering is akin to that of a cartoon explosion, blowing perfectly out from a central source of chaotic causation, like the theoretical birth of the universe. Life and death trapped at once, the death of a shed and the birth of an explosion, a new state of being. This compression of time and childish understanding of a physical reaction may reference the explosiveness of the social concerns of our upbringing. The inspiration for this project is cited by Parker as a product of living with the fear of the IRA, or the Irish Republican Army, bombs while living in London during the 1980s and 1990s, a significant source of anxiety for some of her early years as an artist, and with the shed tried to capture this feeling of perpetual imminent explosiveness, trapped within a fixed moment secured by the hand and will of Parker herself. Like a PTSD moment replayed over and over again in a mind, so does a moment and memory live on in the entity of the exploded shed, even if its existence as a moment in time has faded with the perpetual march of the present. As Parker remarks, the garden shed is where you store things you can't quite throw away. It is perhaps of no consequence that sheds are often where things of the past are stored, or things that are to be used in a present moment of need. The past is eternally implied in a present moment or entity that is memory, or in the case of the shed, a place where memory is stored, acting as a pseudo mind of various experiences manifested in the form of an object or multiple objects held within. Cold Dark Matter is constructed of wood from multiple sheds commissioned by Parker from various shed builders across Soho. The body of the shed itself is a composite of multiple identities formed from numerous landscapes and times of where and when each of these sheds was built. Even if not overtly present, the life of a tree to a shed and then to this particular construct are implied in its very body of a not-quite-so-folk-anymore shed. This compression of identity does not end with Cold Dark Matter's exterior, however. Its insides are formed of collective items from garden sheds that belong to Parker's friends, having donated items they were willing to part with for her cause. The rest were purchases of her own from car boot sales and other goods deemed dismissible, either for profit or not, from others. It is of interest to note that while standard shed, as described by Parker, is a place where objects one is not willing to part with are stored, this particular composite shed is made up of materials unwanted by previous owners. This particular metaphorical mind consists of unwanted memories solidified and stored safely within a homely construct until its volatile outbursts in an exploded view. The post-traumatic nature of the work, while indiscernible if intended in its initial imagining by Parker, it should be noted that Parker initially intended to explode the shed herself under the supervision of an explosive engineer within the gallery of Cold Dark Matter was being exhibited, but for some reason they didn't approve of that, is extended in just who was tasked with the shed's destruction. When debating over whose help to initiate the destruction of her shed, she considered the use of the British Army as a source of her demolition support. It is important to note that at the time Cold Dark Matter was constructed in 1991, The British Army's popularity among the general public was significantly lower due to affairs abroad. Yet Parker appealed to the idea of testing her own ideological barriers, citing that she was aware that this project would feed in the perennial debate about whom you could or couldn't accept as a sponsor of your art. However, I like the idea of working with authority figures, sleeping with the enemy, getting out of my comfort zone, and testing my prejudices. In the end, she sought out the expertise of the Army School of Ammunition, utilizing plastic explosives that were popular with terrorists, as well as the IRA, and reassembled them, blackened Semtex scented remains in the gallery space. This furthers a sensory connection to traumatic experience constructed in the finished works, Eternal Outbursts, whose beam is both annihilative and transformative. The central light of an exploded view hangs from its same position as in Cold Dark Matter, acting as a central constant or ignition point from which the entire exploded shed stems forth in the form of a big bang of sorts. A world of immaterial shadows goes across the walls, echoing the death present in the work's birth. The actual physical explosion that happened inside the shed, suspended eternally in a past that no longer exists and is now reconstructed in a new limbo. An internal unwanted memento suggesting the cerebral nature of the chaos having been delicately hung by Parker with deliberate intention of placement, furthering the orbit of the explosion's material around its central point. Their implied ejection from the shed's interior suggesting a liberation from the clutter of recollection, like a bullet through the brain. Life and destruction are maintained in the eternal present of ersatz and authenticity. Identity and time has become both an infinity and singularity. Even as a shed was born in cold dark matter, its destruction was always implied. This sentiment of inevitable death and life is echoed in a more nuanced piece that furthers the idea of identity as being linked with time. I apologize for the grainy image. I had to use it from the book I was consulting. One day this glass will break is, from a craftsperson's standpoint, rather subdued in its make but hardly in its implications. It was created when Parker was undergoing a residency and became enamored with the challenge of uncreating a work conceptually as she made it. In this case, in the form of six etched glass cups, each inscribed with a single word. When stacked in their intended order, read from top to bottom or bottom to top, they read out the sentence, "One day this glass will break." Each glass operates as a single portable and utilitarian piece, while similarly being necessary to the overall reading of the work as a contingent whole. Each glass is for the most part the same in function and form, though on closer inspection, there are subtle chance differences in how each of the molded pieces turned out. One is reminded of saying that people are all made the same, but few turn out alike. They are further given identity and purpose by the word on their sides, giving each body function only when brought together in the appropriate order, spelling out for us the untimely, if inevitable, fate of each of its members that make up the gestalt consciousness of one day this glass will break. The collective whole of the sentence speaks for each individual, their fates linked in their stacking, but still doomed even if they were by themselves by the simple act of being a portable, fragile object meant for human use. As they are increasingly utilized, they increase their risk of death, like those associated with the act of living as a functional human being. The glass itself is a human invention, acting as a replacement for a time in history when our species' ancestry depended on both their own hands to scoop precious liquids and viands into their persons. In a sense, such a vessel is, though the writer used to loathe such a term, one of the few universal utensils that people have used and as an extension of ourselves. How often have little sighs of sadness escaped when a glass breaks in a fantastic display of hazardous splinters, whether made of glass, ceramic, wood, or any other material deemed appropriate for this little extension of the body. In a way, when a glass or vessel for nourishment breaks or must be cast away, so too dies a little of our tactile past, a little captured moment of what we once were, whether in the form of a favorite sippy cup from childhood or a precious dish in a museum, their meaning lost or subverted by the distance from their previous life of service. Without each of the glasses operating as a whole, each one becomes imbued with their own meaning. A glass saying this can be read much differently from a glass that says glass. That ironically gives them perhaps more meaning as an object meant to be used than one that is read. If their death is implied simply as an object meant to be handled, just as one lives there simultaneously dying, then as a stacked whole, their inescapable doom is hammered home. Isn't this a cheery one? As they are piled, no matter their order, they lean as a precarious tower to the side, the danger of them falling over ever present in the viewer's minds. Reading it acts as an endless mockery in the form of a self-fulfilling prophecy. Given life as read and viewed, much like how any work of art or person is given meaning by the physical effects they induce upon an exterior reality. As Parker is no stranger to the realm of the psychoanalytical, the presence of this death in life is shared in the Freudian idea of the uncanny. As we view the existent, we see the destroyed. The created is in the annihilated and vice versa. This sentiment is echoed in similar philosophies presented around the time these glasses were made in 1997, not too many years after the death of Buddhist teacher Ajahn Chah, who had established several monasteries in England and Parker's formative years as an art student, not far from her place of residency. Having once said, "Do you see this glass? I love this glass. It holds the water admirably. When I tap it, it has a lovely ring. When the sun shines on it, it reflects the light beautifully. But when the wind blows and the glass falls off the shelf and breaks, or if my elbow hits and it falls to the ground, I say, of course. But when I know that the glass is already broken, every minute with it is precious." The identity of alive and dead are present at once, and in it is a fear, but also the subtle appreciation of its continued existence, like the awe and anxiety brought by the Leaning Tower of Pisa, or a monument of history prone to ruin. The haphazard stacking gives us its future identity as a shattered column. One day this glass will break. At one point, these glasses never existed at all. This is a material present at the formation of the universe exists in every body and piece of matter. It is interesting to posit that from this point of initial authenticity of creation, a human body may have more in common with the materials present in a spoon than in a fellow human being. This notion of authentic identity linked to the past and present is continued in another of Parker's works, consisting of six feather photograms, collectively titled Up, Down, Charm, Strange. For the sake of coherency of this larger narrative of fused identity, time, and in this particular instance, place, I shall focus on one particular feather of the series. The feather that went to the top of Everest is an excellent example of how Parker plays with the idea of an authentic identity. The collection of this feather takes place on an almost touristic approach to the places of people of fame, like collecting autographs from celebrities or gift shop trinkets whose existence is meant not only to act as a memento of event, but also a piece of evidence that a place has been visited and interacted with by an individual. It is not an uncommon practice for extensive travels of loved ones and dear friends to bring back said relics of interaction for those they left behind on their journey, as if a kind of truth of culture, time, or place can be wrung out of the corporeal object. An experience made physical to be imbibed by those who cannot access it, like a Chinese vase in an American museum or household. The greater complexity of a vase, of a place, is made accessible and domestic, a transmutation from porcelain to plastic. This obsession is not new, despite its more commercial approach in present souvenirs. The 18th and 19th century of upper middle class households possessing cabinets of curiosities was not uncommon, and there is an almost metaphysical approach to how Parker interacts with these objects present in infinite moments and places, having admitted before that she relishes a tactile pleasure in being able to interact with and curate such objects as a feather from the jacket of the first British woman to climb Mount Everest. Like the sandal of a saint or tertiary relic, there is an almost irreverent hope for the divine to be siphoned from its physical manifestation, a sample of an experience a person acquired enriched the being of its new handler in some way. By being able to touch the tools of Everest sojourners, then in some way a person may indirectly posit that he or she may be able to experience a distant echo of that moment in time or that place that an individual will likely never be acquainted with. The feather is no longer at Everest. For all intents and purposes, it is a simple feather whose significance is constructed in mind rather than reality. Birds can never visit the top of Everest, as it is too high for them to fly, but under the influence of human engineering, parts of their bodies can journey anywhere in the world. Like water through a body returning to air in the form of gas, the transmutation of the contents of objects and bodies into something else entirely is eternally in flux. The dissolution of barriers and identities is largely a product of the need for signifiers to our signifieds, and it is in these cracks of identities and landscapes that such transubstantiations of the everyday object occurs, where bread becomes a body both literally and metaphysically, and where a bird becomes the experience of being at the top of Mount Everest. While the physical moment no longer exists, our propensity for the corporeal feel of memory does. And so too does our appreciation of it. Through such acts of conceptual unpacking, Parker relays an osmosis of time and place present in consciousness, and its effect on our fragile and often fluid approach to how memory and present shapes the identity of not only the self, but our approach to the external world. It is through Parker's subdued yet cerebral approach to her work that she reveals the interdependence of time and identity. A seed is also a tree, wood is a shed, and a glass is shattered just as a feather is at the top of a mountain. Persons too are infinitely compressed as time mutates and reality shift, forever trapped in a solitary structure that stretches out infinitely in the mind and present. Thank you.